Everybody, so what a nice day. We are drizzling outside and we'll be talking exascale programming models. Okay. So I'm DK Panda from Ohio State University. It's a pleasure again coming here, just like previous years, and trying to share some of the things what we are doing in our group. Many of you might have seen this chart from the top 500 list, showing how the field is moving. So this is the line which shows the number one system in the world, and this is the 500 system, and then this is the cumulative performance. And of course, the y-axis is exponential, so things have been like growing in an exponential manner. The number one system is, of course, the Tihane 2, which is the 33 petaflops, and a lot of discussions have taken place for the next level. And many of you must have heard of the systems like Corai and then Coral programs in US. So we'll see like 100 to 200 petaflops machines in the 2016 or 2017. But the next goal is actually the exascale system. And this is where the field is trying to move. And the most people feel that it will be somewhere between 2020 and 2024. Now, if you take that broad goal and then trying to see where we are, this is again the data is taken from the top 500. Here, what it shows is that from 500 systems, how many are clusters? When I say clusters, these are like commodity clusters. That means you can get commodity servers and commodity networking technologies and then put them together. And here you will see that over the years, it has been steadily growing. And in the last November ranking, now 86%. Of the systems, of the top 500 systems are commodity clusters. And what do we mean by the commodity clusters? What are the ingredients? So here, of course, if you see all these systems like Tihane 1, 2, Titan, Stampede, so we'll see that these are mostly like multi-core processors. Of course, we have the accelerators, like both from the NVIDIA GPGPU side as well as the Intel Mic. And then, of course, we have the high-performance interconnects, and especially InfiniBand is playing a big role. So if you take, the November 2014 list, here you will see that there are 225 of these clusters are InfiniBand. That is almost like a 45% of the machines. And just in the top 50, there are already like 21 systems. And the largest system is at the Texas Advanced Computing Center, known as Stampede. Many of you might be familiar. It has actually 500,000 cores. If you combine the host, the Xeon-based things, as well as the Intel Mic cores, so altogether it is a 500,000 cores. And then, of course, there are a lot of these systems all over the world which are deploying InfiniBand in all different shapes and sizes, and more are being installed. So today, what I'll try to focus in that big context, saying how the programming models fit. Okay, when you have these kind of systems, how do you really program? What are the alternatives? Not only just from a user perspective, but how do you design the runtime for these programming models? Because we want to deliver the best performance from the underlying system so that the applications can scale. So that will be the focus of today's talk. And then tomorrow, I'll be talking more on the big data side. The similar kind of issues are also emerging on the big data side and how to accelerate big data on modern systems. So this is a chart I have borrowed from Professor Jack Dangara. What it says is, like, if you take a look at the exascale systems, like people have identified different metrics here, like system peak, power, system memory, node performance, node concurrency, total node interconnect bandwidth, system size, and total concurrency. And this column is telling where we are today. Okay? And then this column is telling where we want to be in the 2020 to 2024. And then the extreme rightmost column is saying, what is the difference? What is the gap? Okay? And there are many interesting numbers here. So let's just focus on some of these ones. Like here, if you see, like currently we have 24 CPU cores and 171 coprocessor cores. And the plan is to actually go to almost each node. We'll have 1,000 or 10,000 cores. So that means we need to have, like, these nodes will grow almost by a factor of like 5 or 50. Okay? Similarly, here, if you see the total interconnect bandwidth, currently we have from a single node going in and out is 6 gigabytes per second. And the plan is to really go for 200 to 400 gigabytes per second. So that means we need to grow, again, by a factor of 40 to 60. The system size, currently there are 16,000 nodes. And the plan is that we'll go almost by 100,000 or 1 million nodes. Okay. So again, there is a gap of factor of 6 to 60. And then the total concurrency, which is like currently there are 12.48 million threads, and the goal is that almost we'll have order of billion threads to hide the latency from the CPU to the memory. So as you can see that as a summary, there is a really big gap. And that's what makes it also exciting or challenging in the field, just like everybody else in this room. Hopefully, like by 2020 and 2024, we'll totally cross it out, saying we have achieved everything. But we'll see. Okay, still we have like 5 to 9 years to take care of this. So in that kind of like a broad framework, again, many of you must be familiar with the MPI, which is the message passing interface standard. That is the most common programming model being used in all the systems. And of course, there is like shared memory, which is the cache coherent shared memory. And as you know, it is very hard to design very large scale cache coherent shared memory. So mostly these days it is available within a node or across a set of nodes. There are different products out there to scale it to certain number of cores, but not to the very large ones. So to bridge the gap, there is a new kind of programming models are coming called partition global address space, or called PGAS. How many of you have heard of this term? Okay, quite a few. Okay, so the idea is that these are still logical shared. Physically they are distributed just like the distributed memory machine, but the abstraction is trying to provide a logical shared memory so that we can actually do, from a programmer's perspective, we can actually do read and write or get and put across these nodes, and that's what is will make things much more easier. So if you take a look at like what are the challenges in designing these exascale systems from a very high level perspective, we saw that in the previous table. So these are something, of course, the energy and power challenge, that has been the biggest thing because the target is to have like 18 megawatt to put the machine. And of course, the data movement consumes power. And of course, there are memory and storage challenges. We want high capacity as well as high data rate. And we, of course, need concurrency and locality challenges so that management of very large amount of concurrency, as I indicated earlier, these kind of systems will have almost billion threads. So how do you manage that kind of concurrency on these large systems? And of course, there is a resiliency challenge. Now, if you take a look at the MPI, MPI has been there for many years. And the question is like how MPI can actually address the exascale challenge. So the community has been continuously moving along this direction. Now, especially for the data movement operations, since power is the most important thing, there are certain things have been worked out in the MPI standard to reduce that kind of a power or reduce the data movement. So few of these things are like here, non-blocking collectives. I'll talk into more details later on. The traditionally, if some of you would have done MPI programming, you will see that they use typically the blocking collectives. So that means, let's say if I do an all-to-all, or I do a reduce, or a broadcast, all the computational processes, they initiate the operation, but then they wait for the results to be done. And during that time, the CPUs are just polling. They're not doing anything. There's no real computation is taking place. So not only that leads to inefficiency, it also leads to a lot of power consumption. So the idea is to have non-blocking collective. So instead of trying to do all-to-all, we'll try to do I all-to-all. Or instead of like reduce, I reduce. So the idea is that you initiate the collective operation, but then the processors are free to proceed with the computation, provided they have computations left from the previous iterations. Okay. So in that case, the computations can proceed. And when the new results come out, then the computations, the processors can go to the next level. So this will allow the true overlap of computation with communication. And I'll show some examples later on how we can achieve that. Then similarly, the MPI standard is also trying to go for like one-sided interface. This was introduced in the MPI 2, like a get and put, but it was not very efficient. The new MPI 3 standard has come up with better synchronization schemes so that you can actually do get and put kind of things in the MPI libraries easily. And then to manage concurrency, this is where the PGAS is coming. So the idea is to combine this MPI as well as PGAS, and then of course the resilience issues are there. So if you take a look at the MPI forum, they have been like working hard on finalizing the standards. So in fact, these are some of the three major things. In the MPI 3, I introduced like non-blocking collectives and improved one-sided RMA model. I'll also talk a little bit about MPI tools later on. So this is also coming as a new thing. Earlier, if you remember, like, let's say you are a programmer and you have run some application on a large system and you are not getting performance. So then you try to break your head saying where the performance is, you are losing out. So then you need to go not only in the application layer, you also need to go inside the MPI library and then see what is happening. And typically, any MPI library these days has almost 200 to 300 parameters. These are like tuning parameters, different knobs you can tune to extract performance. So unless you exactly know how the MPI library is doing, it's very hard to know where you are losing the performance. So to alleviate that kind of bottleneck, this is the new thing which has been introduced, like an MPI tools interface. So the idea is that the MPI library designers can expose some of their important parameters to the upper layers so that the tools or even the application developers can query the value of these parameters and try to see whether that matches with the application behavior, and if not, they can actually drive the MPI library to change those parameters while things are running. Okay, so it is like a query and control behavior will help the next generation, like the systems, to have a very good interaction between the library designers, MPI library designers, the application library designers, and also the tool developers to work together to have a very good understanding of what is going on. Okay, so that is one of the important contribution of the MPI 3. And of course, MPI 3.1 is underway. Like the last MPI forum meeting, it has been read. Everything is going on, so very soon you will see the formal 3.1 is coming out, and then the next goal is to go to MPI 4. So as I indicated in these PGAS models, these are actually, the target is that these are like simple shared memory abstraction on top of the distributed memory model. We said like it is a logical shared memory so that you can do get and put operations. The benefits are here that it tries to provide you lightweight one-sided communication. And also it is much more easier to program. We'll see some examples later on. And it is easier to express irregular communication. So that is the key word. If you have an application which has a lot of regular communication pattern, then MPI is good enough. Okay, like if it's a 2D stencil or 4D or some typical like near-neighbor exchange kind of things. But when it becomes very irregular, you don't know like where how to do load balancing properly, where the data is moving. This is where the PGAS models shine. Okay, so the question is like, can we also take advantage of like this PGAS models to handle this kind of irregular applications? And of course, there are different approaches people are working on, language-based things and library-based things. So I'll touch a little bit of these in the language-based, the UPC and then the OpenSMEM, and also the language-based, these two, and then the library-based is the OpenSMEM. That's what I'll try to focus on. So when both this MPI and PGAS are there, so the next challenge is that can we combine them to get the best advantage of both these programming models. So as we see, like the next generation system, of course, is becoming more and more hierarchical. So at different levels, you will see different kinds of like connectivity, different kinds of coherency, and that leads to different kinds of address spaces. So can we do something like MPI across the address space and PGAS within an address space? Okay. And if we do that, MPI is good at moving data between address spaces. And within an address space, MPI can interoperate with other shared memory programming models. In that way, we can actually have the advantage of both the things. And please note that this can coexist with OpenMP. Many people mix PGAS models with OpenMP. OpenMP can still be there, which is trying to utilize the multiple cores for the computation. Okay, so this is the MPI and the PGAS hybrid. We are talking about the communication. And on top of that, you can see that, let's say, the applications can have kernels with different kinds of communication patterns. Now the question is, can they benefit? Like, let's say I have an application, very long, 100,000 lines of code, and let's say it is not scaling. Now the question is, yeah, you tell somebody saying, yeah, go and rewrite it. But there is very little chance that somebody will really go and rewrite this application using a new programming model. So the idea here is that can we mix and match? For example, if you, let's say, this is your big application which has been written for many years and it is not scaling. So it could be that few of these kernels, they are not scaling, okay? And if you can identify those and then rewrite, let's say this is where like some irregular communication was taking place, this is where some load balancing issues were there. And if you can rewrite those parts using PGAS, and then you can mix them together, then you have a hybrid program, MPI and PGAS. Then if you can have a hybrid runtime to support these kind of programming models, then you will see you can get the benefits of both distributed computing models as well as the PGAS model. And once again, towards the end, I'll try to show some concrete examples. In our group, we have done these kind of things, and we see very good benefits for some of the applications by using this kind of hybrid programming models. So if we put all these things together and try to see that what are the broad challenges, okay, in designing this kind of communication libraries, so here you will see that at the bottommost, we have these three ingredients I talked about, multi-core, many-core architectures, accelerators, and all the different networking technologies. Could be InfiniBand or 4800 Gigi or Cray Aries or the Intel's OmniPath. So all these things, think of them as supply side. That means these technologies are coming to us. And then, of course, the topmost layer is the applications or the kernels. And we want to deliver the performance at that layer. And typically, those are written with some middleware. And these middlewares are written with some programming models. This is where we are talking MPI or PGAS. Even it could be CUDA or OpenACC, Silk. And of course, for the big data, which I'll be talking tomorrow, it's like Hadoop or MapReduce, et cetera. So now the challenge is that we need to take all the features from these components and try to deliver the performance here, or in the other way, try to design some communication library or programming models which actually encompasses all the best features and then try to deliver it at the programming models layer. So that if somebody is talking, trying to do a MPI operation, whether it's a point-to-point or collectives or some PGAS operations, those are feature rich. And also performance is there and scalability is there. So then if the applications are running on top of these libraries, they will get the best performance and scalability. So that's what in my group, we have been working almost for last 20 to 25 years. Focusing a lot of these designs of point-to-point communication, collective, synchronization log, IO file systems, fault tolerance, et cetera, and I'll share some of those things in the remaining part of the talk. Now, in addition to like working only at one layer, there is a lot of new things are happening called co-design, okay? So the idea here is that as the machines are becoming so complicated, if you just take a look at only one layer, you may not be able to optimize in the best possible manner. So the question is, can we consider some of the layers together? And that is the co-design kind of opportunities to design this kind of, to meet the goal of performance, scalability, and fault resilience. And once again, I'll show some examples, especially this non-blocking collective operations. So you will see that it needs work at all three layers, at the application layer, at the runtime layer, even in the hardware layer. Okay? And if they can work together, you'll see the best kind of benefits. So to, if we abstract it up, then if somebody asks you a question, let's say the next generation Exascale systems will have this MPI plus X. That is a very generic way people are trying to address this issue because nobody knows what this X will be. It could be OpenMP with some PGAS or any of these PGAS models, so nobody knows exactly at this point. But these will be the kind of your bullets or the challenges. So the first, we need to have scalability for million to billion process. So that means we need to have very highly efficient inter-node and intra-node communication, not only across the nodes, but we also have to focus on within the node. Okay, and that means both like the point-to-point as well as one-sided, two-sided, all those operations. And of course, we have to focus on this collective communication because this is where a lot of time goes in large-scale systems. So a lot of things are happening here, offloading, non-blocking, topology aware, power aware kind of things. And as I indicated earlier, these nodes will become fatter and fatter. So that means we need to somehow balance intra-node and inter-node communication. If we don't balance it properly, then you will see that the system, whatever we design, is not a balanced environment. And of course, with many of these multi-core, many-core, there is a lot of increasing focus on multi-threading these days. So how exactly you have lightweight threads, and how do you run these? How do you do communication with these lightweight threads to achieve the maximum concurrency? And also the GPUs and then the Intel Xeon Phi, those are coming at like an accelerator and coprocessor, and they also require an integrated support into this runtime. And I'll show some examples how to achieve that. And then, of course, fault tolerance, resiliency, QA support, and I talked about this hybrid MPI PGAS programming. And finally, also the new direction, which has been there for some time, virtualization, which is primarily being used in the enterprise domain, but HPC has not adopted it. Okay, so the broad thing is that as soon as we talk about HPC, virtualization has overhead. So then people, they don't go together. Now the question is, can we do some kind of virtualization schemes with very little overhead so that it can actually be brought into HPC? And then a lot of issues, with, especially for fault tolerance, process migration, those kind of issues will be very easy to handle. Okay? So those are all the kind of wish list we want to do. Now, in a different direction, what we'll see that there are some additional challenges. And the first one is to achieve these two or to design these kind of runtime libraries with extremely low memory footprint. So what does that mean? That means as these runtimes are becoming more complex, you'll see that any runtime or libraries, you need to define some queues, you need to define some buffers, you need to establish some connections, etc. As the system sizes are increasing, the runtime itself is becoming or consuming more and more memory. But then that is not good, because then the application is being deprived of using the memory. So let's say you have nodes with 32 gigabytes, and then you come up with a library saying, okay, I want to consume 4 gigabytes. Okay. That's not good, because then the application people are complaining, saying, no, I mean, I need to, my jobs are not scaling. So the broad objective is that to reduce that, the memory footprint of these libraries, so that the applications can actually have more and more memory. The second aspect, I call it like a DLA framework, and this is becoming more important as these systems are becoming more complex. It's like I call discover, learn, and adapt. Okay. So the idea is that as these large-scale systems are coming, when the job is running, it can have a lot of complex interaction. I mean, think of like the tax stampede with 500,000 cores. There are so many jobs are running together. Your traffic might be contending with other traffic, or within your job itself, they are going through, depending on the allocation, they are running and contending with that at all different places. So the question is, can we actually find out or discover the overall network topology for processes for a given job, node architecture, health of network and node, and as the job is running, learn, kind of trying to see if that is the mode in which I am running is the best or not. Okay, and what will be if I want to change it, then what should be the impact on performance and scalability and potential for failure, and then quickly adapt. And adapt means the internal protocols, algorithms, process mapping, fault tolerance solutions. And this is just like, let's say, I mean, just like we do on a day-to-day driving. If you think of like going from your home to work or work to home, you never always take exactly the same path. Right, depending on the situation, depending on the traffic and all, you do this DLA framework. You go through it every day. And that's what we want these next generation runtime libraries to actually to do. Okay, so in that case, they can actually take care of like the best set of ways to run it on a given system. And of course, in order to do this, we want low overhead techniques. Because if that overhead is very high, then you don't win. Okay, so we need to have low overhead while delivering performance, scalability, and fault tolerance. So in that context, let me go and try to share some of the results, what we have been doing. Many of you might be familiar with this, our MBAPIS project. We started this almost day one of InfiniBand in the year 2000. And prior to this, we were working on all the prior technologies like Marinette, Quadrix, Cray T3D, all those systems. When InfiniBand came in, we just jumped in. And we had the first MPI 1 version available in the 2002, the supercomputing 2002. And then since then, we have been continuously like evolving our MPI stack with respect to all the latest standards. Last several years, we also have the hybrid version, the MPI and PGAS. I'll talk about that in a little bit more details. We also have integrated support for GPUs and also mic since last year. I'll try to share some of the numbers. So currently, it's being used by more than 2,300 organizations in 75 countries. We have taken it from a project from academia, but now it is a really production code. And just from OSU site, we crossed like 242,000 downloads. Okay, so every week we get around 1,500 downloads from our site. So in few weeks, we'll actually cross 250,000 mark. Okay, and again, this is running in a production manner. Like when in the 2000, when we were really working on the very early stage of InfiniBand, I remember like we had a tough time to even to have run it on two nodes. Okay, I'm talking about 2000 technology, but then now it is running in a production manner on all these systems like Stampede, Pleiades, Swami, etc., and a lot of large systems, they are actually running our stack. And broadly, like if you take a look at, some of you might be remembering like the System X from Virginia Tech, that was like a 2003, it was one of the number three in the world. That was the first large InfiniBand cluster. Okay, so since then, like that was only like 2,200 processors with only 12 teraflops, and now talk about Stampede with 5 petaflops with 500,000 cores. So we have been enabling the community to go through all these large scale systems every year, and then try to really push them into this top 500 things. So in that context, I'll actually take some sample case studies to illustrate these ideas so that you can get a feel for these challenges and where we stand. So I'll start with some of the basic performance, like how we are able to deliver you highly efficient inter-node and intra-node communication. I'll talk about some extremely minimum memory footprint, how we are able to achieve. Then I'll talk about some of the collective communication, integrated support for GPUs, mic. I'll go into a little bit more details on the MPI-T interface I talked about. Then the unified runtime, and some of the very recent work we are doing on the virtualization, and I will show you some numbers. So we'll have a new release coming out of with SRIOB with OpenStack. Okay, so I'll try to show you some of the early numbers there. Any questions so far? I know this is a morning session, so you need to ask questions, okay? So that you can remain awake, I'll remain awake also, okay? It is middle of the night in Columbus, okay? Any questions? Everybody's fine so far? Okay, so let's continue. So this is the chart I'm trying to show, like how things have been evolving over the years. What it's trying to show, all different kinds of adapters over the last several years. I didn't include the SDR, which has become really ancient now. So these are like the QLogic as well as Mellanox, ConnectX2, ConnectX3, ConnectIB, single dual port with different platforms. So this chart is showing like a MPI level latency, okay, half of round trip. Okay, like I send you a message and you send me back half of that. And you see over the years, we are steadily reducing. So now we are hovering almost like one or little less than 1 microsecond. So this is with MAPIS 2. And of course, you can do similar kind of things with any other MPI stack. But the broad idea here, you will see that we have almost reduced by half, 1.82 microsecond, 2.99 microseconds. And now, since the new EDR has come, I don't have the EDR things yet, but I am hoping that it'll go down to like 0.8, 0.75 microseconds. So for many years, there was a big challenge that can we take MPI microsecond below one? And that's what it has already achieved. And the right-hand side, we are trying to show the bandwidth. So this is the rate at which we can push the data. And here you will see that there is a clear gap kind of thing. So this is like a DDR, QDR, this is FDR, and then this is the dual FDR. I am hoping the EDR will also match with these numbers. This is like 12.8 gigabytes per second. If you multiply by 8, so it is 100 gigabits. Okay, so this is where all these commodity technologies lie.
So the EDR will also have reduction in your latency switch. It's not reflected here, but
the yeah, yeah. So these numbers are all with switch. Okay, so these are all with switch. We always show the numbers. So yes, once we get a EDR adapter and switch, I'll report the numbers. So not only the inter-node communication matters, as I indicated, a lot of these nodes are becoming very fat. So that means a lot of communication happens within the node also. So for any of the programming models, you need to also make sure that the communication within the node happens much more faster. And that also we have been working over the years in a very steady manner, trying to provide the best support. So here it is a number, like intra-socket, this is Ivy Bridge. So here you will see it is 180 nanoseconds. We can send data, MPI communication, from one of the core to the other core within the same socket. And across the socket, it's around 450 nanoseconds, okay? So we have almost gone from like fourth or fifth generation of redesigning the shared memory communication there. Now, that is for short messages. For large messages, it also matters. So typically, if you use shared memory, there are two processes. The standard way is to write to the shared memory and then read from the other shared memory. But then that is a two copy. Okay. Now, many years back, we introduced some kind of a one copy scheme using a kernel module. Okay, and that scheme was called Limink. And over the years, in fact, similar mechanisms have actually come in the standard Linux kernel. Okay, so the latest one is called CMA, cross memory attach. So you don't need a separate kernel module, it is already available in the kernel. And our library actually takes advantage of that also. And here you can see, like, let's say the bandwidth, there is a big gap. If you can, what you can do, shared memory, the traditional shared memory versus the CMA or the LIMIC. So if you are running MWAPH2, I'll strongly encourage you to turn on these knobs so that you will actually get more performance out of the system. Now, of course, the MPI-3, I talked about this RMA operation. That is a new way is coming to do get and put kind of things. And we have been also heavily optimizing those kind of operations in our library. So here it shows some number, like inter-node, get, put. You can get it like done with 1.56 microsecond. The bandwidth you get almost the same as the node. And these are some numbers within the socket. So we can also try to optimize those. Now, coming to the memory footprint, as some of you know, like this has become a big challenge, not only just for the library designers, but also like from the network perspective. As the InfiniBand in the beginning had like only UD, which is the unreliable datagram, and then the RC, which is the reliable connection. Now, as you know, the reliable connection, it gives the best performance, but you have to establish connection. And as the system size becomes bigger and bigger, you need more and more connections. That means more buffers. And this is where your more memory footprint goes. So what we have done, of course, there are some solutions like instead of RC, XRC was introduced. So here it shows an example like how the simple RC to XRC, if you move, you reduce your memory. In fact, you can also get a little bit of benefits in terms of performance because of the reduced cache thrashing or the connection thrashing. But what we have done is we have actually introduced a hybrid mode, okay? Or you can think of it as like a pure UD, pure RC slash XRC, or somewhere in between, okay? So this is just like hybrid car. So think of like hybrid car. We want to give you the best mileage per gallon, okay? But then we need to determine when to run on gas and when to run on electric, okay? And that is the kind of concept we have taken to inside the MPI library. So if you just turn on some of the very simple configuration flags here, like saying either pure UD or do this hybrid. So what it does is, as soon as the job gets launched, it has some internal mechanism to find out who is communicating with whom and in what frequency, okay? So the idea is that, let's say on a very large scale system, let's say you have submitted a 60,000 core job, it is not that everybody is communicating with everybody else. It's only some set of processes are frequently communicating. And that's what we want to stick to RC. to get the best performance. Whereas if your some of the processes are casually communicating with each other, we want to use the UD, okay, so that we reduce the memory footprint. And also we keep a cap on how many connections can be established so that the total memory footprint is not increasing. So all these things are happening inside. So this is the DLA framework I indicated earlier. So it is trying to discover, it's trying to learn, and then it is trying to adapt. Okay. So once again, I'll strongly suggest if you have like very large scale jobs you are running and you are finding the memory footprint issues, turn on this knob. And then you will be able to see that you can run large scale jobs with reduced memory footprint. Then the new one, which is Mellanox has introduced, called the DC transport. That's the direct connect transport. So we did some study here. This was presented in last year ISC. So here you will see that the memory footprint, think of like this is the connection memory. This axis is number of processes. So this is like RC. This is UD. This is XRC. This is the DC. So that reduces the memory footprint significantly. And also here it's an application, the NAMD with APOA 1 large data set. So here with the DC pool is trying to give you in fact the best execution time. And in the next release in the few months, you will see this DC support is available in the Apache 2 stack. So now let me move into a little bit of the collective communication. The collective communication is like, as we saw earlier, like let's say you think of like an all-to-all, BCAST, all these operations. As the system size increases, you spend more time there. So here, InfiniBand provides this hardware multicast support that is available with only UD. And these are the numbers. This is on the tag stampede with 102,000 cores. Here you will see that the latency, this is the hardware multicast versus this is the software where you try to do some tree-based scheme. You see the communication remains almost flat, 5 to 10 microseconds. For a 16-byte message size, if the system size increases, still you see very flat number here. Okay. So we have used that as a fundamental component in our library, and a lot of other collectives are built on top of this. Okay. So if you have a very large-scale deployment, just again, this is default. You should be able to see the benefits here. So always compile with the UD multicast support, and you will see the performance gain. Now, I talked about this non-blocking collective, so let me go into a little bit more details. So the idea is the MPI-3 introduce these non-blocking collectives. As I said, you can trigger a collective and let the collective happen in the background, and then if you have some computation, you can continue. But then it means that your application has to be redesigned. Your current applications, if you just turn on from blocking collectives to non-blocking collectives, you don't expect performance gain. Okay? And at the same time, the question is, while the collective is happening in the background, who is making the progress? That is also a big thing. So if you use a core to do the progress, then you are hampering with the collectives. But on the other hand, if you have like a hardware like the Mellanox core direct, so that means the adapter is trying to progress, so then you are in a good shape. And that's what all these studies, what we did is we worked with some application scientists. We also took the core direct and then modified our library. Okay. So here if you see like, let's say that we modified P3DFFT, we worked some Lawrence Livermore people with modified pre-conjugate gradient solver. Even we modified the HPL. So here you can see, like using this co-design approach, you can actually provide benefits. Here, 17% benefits in execution time. Here, 21% benefit even the HPL, 4.5% benefits, kind of thing. So this is the next level of solutions which will be coming out in the library, in the Apache 2 library to support these non-blocking collectives. Now the topology is becoming very important again. Here again, I'll try to drive that DLA principle. So on a large-scale system, let's say you submit a big job, how do you know that your job, especially the collectives, are running in the best manner or even the point-to-point? Because think of like, let's say, designing a collective algorithm. The fundamental assumption is that all the processes are running in a contiguous allocation. This is how you design your algorithm, whether it's a k-nomial, some binomial, any kind of all-to-all algorithms. But as soon as you run it on a big job or a big cluster, you are not guaranteed to get the contiguous allocation. So your fundamental assumption breaks there. So now the question is, can we discover? And especially InfiniBand Subnet Manager allows you to discover the where the job is running. And based on that, can we take some decisions saying instead of running broadcast algorithm 1, should I be running broadcast 2 or broadcast 3 for that topology and then get the best performance out? So here, we are trying to show how you can even do very simple placement of processes. Okay, so that means let's say you have a 4,000 core job, your scheduler is giving you 4,000 cores, but they need not be again contiguous. They can be some random things in the system. So can we actually do some reordering before the job runs so that we know that the MPI rank 0 is going here, 1 is going here, 2 is going here? And this study we did on the Ranger, which was the precursor to Stampede, and what it shows here, like this, the milk application. So this is like trying to show intra-node, like how much communication is happening here. Then the green one is like one hop, five hop, seven hop, three hops communication. So the idea is to maximize the intra-node communication, okay? Because then you will have the reduced no contention at all. And then also minimize the one hop, three hops, five hops, seven hops. And if we can do that, and this is what we did, this was a C12 best paper and best 20 paper finalist. So with this, you can see that this was the before running and after running, we were able to boost the intra-node communication and also reduced like this one hop, three hop, five hops. And that led to reduced contention. And effectively now we get 15% benefit in the execution time. Okay, so we need to deploy these kind of advanced schemes to run these applications with the best performance and scalability. Now, of course, the power is becoming also very important these days. Again, if you think of like the collectives, a lot of power goes there. So the question is, can we design these collective algorithms in a totally different manner? Of course, there are like solutions like frequency scaling and all. But what we apply, what we design here is like a new kind of algorithms. Think of like a game, football game or a soccer game. When the game finishes, everybody tries to go home, right? Nobody makes progress. This is where the biggest contention happens. Okay, so what we did is similar kind of things, trying to take that knowledge. So let's say you have a 32 core per node. If all 32 cores start communicating a collective, nobody's making progress. So what we did is we came up with different phases. Okay, so let's say 32 cores, we allow let's say 8 cores to go ahead with a communication, and remaining 24 cores, we can reduce the voltage. Okay, so in the next phase, the next 8 cores come in and the remaining 24 cores go to the lower frequency. So if you use this kind of scheme, you will see that you will almost significantly reduce the power. That's what we are seeing, like 32% benefits in the power. You may get a hit a little bit of performance. So there is a trade-off between the performance. You may lose a little bit, but again, you can win a lot in the power. So we again need to design this kind of newer algorithms to have the best solution. So let me move ahead. Then the question is, how do we provide support for GPGPUs? Now, this is very interesting. So think of like any GPGPU cluster. Now, currently what happens, very simple things, you try to do a CUDA mem copy, then you do an MPI send, and then you do a CUDA mem copy again. That is a very normal way people are trying to program these GPU systems. But then the question is, this leads to a lot of higher latency. So we call this like saying this is high productivity, but it's low performance. Okay. Now, of course, there are some advanced users. What they do is, if you have some data in the GPUs, you try to pipeline it using like a CUDA mem copy async, and then you also try to do it MPI isend. Okay, so that you achieve the pipelined approach, and then finally you wait all. So this is good. You get high productivity, high performance, but the productivity is low. This is the end scientist or engineer or some biochemist. He is trying to find out what this MPI library is doing, what CUDA is doing. They should rather focus on their science. Okay, so what we asked ourselves, can we do something like a CUDA-aware MPI? Okay, so that means the end user doesn't even have to touch CUDA. Can we do everything within the MPI library? And this is what we targeted, saying just like you do an MPI send receive from user buffer at the host, you can try to do same thing from the GPU buffer. Okay, and within the library, we support everything so that you get the best performance and you will get the best productivity. So we started this project almost 4 years back. We had some initial numbers, and then NVIDIA came out, provided some funding to us saying, okay, take this solution and then push it into the MapPisto library, and that's what we have done over the years. So we have provided all kinds of support, not just internode, intranode, CUDA IPC, optimized collectives, the data types. So it's a full set of solutions we have been enabling. And also we have extended into the very latest, the GPU Direct RDMA. As many of you know, the GPU Direct RDMA, if you have the IB and GPU adapter, they can actually communicate over the PCI Express without going to the host. But at the same time, there are some limitations here. For example, if you read from like IB to the GPU, you get good performance, whereas the other path is not good. Okay, that is a limitation of the Intel chipset. So to alleviate that, this red path, actually we take it through the host and then bring it back. Okay, so we have a hybrid design running there. And this is the very latest design. You can see MapPisto is GPU Direct RDMA. So this is like, again, a small message latency, GPU to GPU, like a local GPU to the remote GPU. This was like without the GPU Direct RDMA, like 20 microsecond latency. Last year, we reduced it to around 6 microsecond. And now see this number, 2.37 microsecond. We can send data from one GPU to the other GPU. So many times people have thought that the GPUs are not good for applications with small messages. That is not true any longer. So if you have really application with small messages, use our library, okay? You will be able to really see the performance. This is a two-sided. The medium message sizes, we are able to give bandwidth improvement compared to almost factor of 10. This is the 2.2. Bidirectional bandwidth also similar, factor of 10. And also, we have the full-fledged support of MPI-3, RMA operation from GPU to GPU. So here you can see like 2.88 microseconds. And there is no other MPI library now which gives this kind of performance. Okay. So if you want to use it, just go download these things. This is trying to show an applications like Humdi Blue, which is a University of Michigan application. We have shown very good weak scalability as well as strong scalability here. So these are the things. If you go to the MapPisto page, you will see how exactly to install it. You just need different kinds of drivers, both from Mellanox and NVIDIA. There is also a library from NVIDIA called GDR Copy. So if you put all of them together, you will see the kind of performance what I've indicated earlier. Okay. So similar kind of things also, we are working with the Intel Mic. As you know, Intel Mic provides you all these different programming models, symmetry, coprocessor, offload, or reverse offload. So if you analyze the communication, here it shows like where MPI processes can run. So that means this is the host. You can have different GN5s here. This is IB. So there are a lot of different possible paths. Okay, like you have intra-socket, inter-socket, inter-node, intra-mic, intra-socket. So like the list goes on, so there are 11 possible paths within an MPI library you need to optimize. That is for point-to-point. Okay, so, and on top of that, you need to also optimize collectives. That is a much more bigger challenge. Okay, so we have done all these kind of things. We support actually all these offload mode, intra-node, inter-node, kind of things. And of course, these optimizations lead to the good performance. As you might be knowing, in the Intel Mic, the claim is that any code will run. But the question is, are you getting the performance? Okay. So this is where it shows. Like, let's say this is the basic MapPisto, it will run. But it may not give you the best performance. Whereas you optimize, like our optimized version, you can see we can reduce significantly the latency. We can push the bandwidth. This is like intra-socket. This is inter-socket. Similarly, like the collectives. So let's say this is a 32-node all gather. We can reduce communication time, all to all, etc. As well, like let's say the P3D FFT. So this is the optimized version. You can see that you can get the benefit. So we had a public version released in December, and this version is actually running on three of these large scale systems like Stampede, BlueJean in Virginia Tech, as well as Bacon in UTK. So if you have not tried out this library, again, I'll strongly suggest you to download and see. You should be able to get a boost in your application execution time. So I talked about this MPIT interface, so let me go into a little bit more details. As I said, in the any MPI library, there are kind of two different categories of variables. One is the control variables, and another is the performance variable. So these variables are used to configure and tune MPI internals, and these are like to get insights into the performance of an MPI library. Like I talked about this memory consumption, timing, resource usage. A lot of informations are there in the MPI library to know what is going on. So the overall framework of this MPIT is like you can actually query any of these variables, performance and control, and then once you analyze it to see what is going on, you can trigger again the control variables. Okay? Now, very simple example I can tell you. So let's say those who are familiar with MPI, you know there is a common parameter called eager threshold. Okay? If your application, let's say it is 8 kilobytes, less than 8 kilobytes, I follow eager protocol. More than 8 kilobytes, I follow the rendezvous protocol. So every MPI library has these values set up. But might be that it was set up as an 8 kilobyte and your application average message size is 9 kilobyte. So you are just missing it narrowly and your performance is very bad because the rendezvous takes more time. If you can discover that, then what you can control your MPI library is saying you make the first run, and if you analyze, then from the second round onwards, you put this eager threshold to a higher value. It is as simple as that. So you discover saying what is going on, and then you trigger. And it could be done across iterations, or if you have a large running job, in fact, you can modify it in the middle also. Okay? Like you have finished, let's say, some phases of your computation, and you are doing some analysis saying you are not getting performance. From afterwards, you can tell the MPI library, change these values. Okay? And this is a totally new way. You will see the programming will happen, and the MPIT interface in the MPI standard will allow you to achieve this. So we have enabled a lot of these kind of variables in our library, and we are continuously exposing more and more variables. So if you have not, again, tried any one of these, I'll strongly suggest you to try that. So let me then go into this hybrid programming models. I indicated like you can get benefits of both MPI and PGAS. But then the question is, you need to have a runtime which can support both. So there have been a lot of solutions in the literature. Some people run PGAS on top of MPI, but then you don't get performance. Sometimes there could also be deadlock. So we looked at this problem almost like 4 years back, and we have been designing something called a unified communication runtime. And through this, here you can see, you can make MPI calls, UPC calls, or CoRE Fortran, or OpenSMM calls, and that will lead you to all possibilities here. You can run your job with MPI OpenMP, or pure OpenSMM, pure UPC, pure CAF, MPI OpenMP, OpenSMM, any combination of these programming models. And that actually gives you a very fair way to determine which programming model is the best for your application. Okay? Many times in the literature, you see some comparison of these programming models, but they do like a apples to orange comparison. Something from Blue Gene and something from IB. They're not fair. So here what we are trying to do with the unified communication runtime, we give you the best performance and scalability for all these programming models. Okay? So then it's left to the application developer to find out what is the best. So here I'm trying to show, let's say, pure OpenSMM. So here you can see like there are different designs like University of Houston OpenSMM, there is an OpenMPI, Scalable SMM with FCA, this is our MIPS2 SMM, so this is like a heat image and this is a DAXP, and you can see that we are able to give you the best performance benefit. Now this is interesting, this is the hybrid. So we took this Graph 500, which is a very common benchmark these days being used to rank all these systems from the Graph 500 perspective. And we analyzed this code and we saw that there are a few kernels where things are happening in an irregular manner. Okay? So we took the publicly available version of the MPI. There are three versions out there, MPI Simple, MPI CSC, MPI CSR. In fact, the CSC and CSR don't scale. Okay? So what we did is we took this MPI, found out these kernels where things were not scaling, and we modified them to OpenSMM. And we stitched them together. So this was a hybrid program, MPI and OpenSMM. And that can run on our MIPS2X hybrid runtime and see the benefit. This is on the TAC Stampede with 16,000 cores and we can give you 13 factor of improvement. Okay, by using this kind of hybrid version, and that also shows very strong scalability as well as weak scalability. Okay, similar kind of things we have done for sort. This is a pure sort application, which a lot of people use, similar kind of things. By doing this hybrid design, we are able to, on a 4 terabyte sort on a 4,000 core, we are able to give you 51% benefit. Okay, so like this, we have done for some more applications. And here, especially, if you have an application which is not scaling, we'll be very happy to work with you. And we'll be try to use those as a case studies and then try to see whether you can we can scale it. So very recently, the very latest RC2, again, we have provided the support for CoRA Fortran. There was a lot of request to enable this for some time, so we have done this, the leaf CAF, and then we have gone into our MVAPH2 design. Here there are some detailed numbers. You can see, like, compared to the different solutions like a GasNet, InfiniBand, GasNet MPI, we are able to deliver you the best performance in latency, as well as some of the collectives. So if you have not used it, this is like the RC2 we just released recently, so please feel free to use that. Just last week, we released this. You should be able to use the CoRA Fortran support now with MVAPH2. So finally, let me touch this. This is the last topic. We are almost winding up. So the virtualization. So as I indicated earlier, like virtualization has many benefits, but they are not very popular in the HPC due to the overhead associated. And of course, the SRIOV, which is the single root IO virtualization, that is gaining a lot of prominence. Earlier, it was available with Ethernet. Mellanox people have taken it to the InfiniBand. So we have been working on some initial designs of MVAPH2 with SRIOV support with OpenStack. Okay, so I'll show some numbers, and this version again will be available publicly very soon. So here it shows some of the numbers. So here, if you see, this is like the, again, the latency and bandwidth. This is the inter-node, inter-VM. So what I'm trying to show is the IB native and then the IB SRIOV. Of course, for very short messages, there is some overhead. That is the IB level. Okay, there's nothing to do with the MPI level. But as soon as you go into the medium and large messages, you see very little overhead. Okay, so that with SRIOV, we can achieve the best performance. So we have taken our MVAPH2 library and put it on top of this. So here, what it's trying to show, like, we have, again, this is the inter-node, point-to-point latency and bandwidth. So here you can say, again, the similar kind of degradation exists because of the basic IB. But as soon as you go into the middle, medium, and top, we don't see that. And we also did a comparison with MV2, MVAPH2 on the Amazon EC2. Of course, they are only running 10 gigi, not like the InfiniBand, just for a comparison, because many people ask us. So here you'll see that latency-wise, we are able to get like a benefits of factor of 29 and bandwidth by factor of 16. Okay. And then this is the intranode. So this is where we have done a lot of optimizations. If you think of, like, the VMs are running, many times the VMs, they are running on the same node, but they don't know that they're running on the same node. They might be using loopback. Okay, so here we have taken all our shared memory designs and then put it there. Okay, so that as soon as these multiple VMs are running on the same node, they can actually use our shared memory designs. Okay, and through that, here you can see, again, like, let's say this MV2, this is the SRIOV default, this is the optimized, and this is the MV2 native. So if you do that, here you'll see almost like we have reduced that gap to 5% here. And if you take some application, this is like a 8 VM, 8 cores for VM. This is trying to show the default, this is the optimized, and this is the native. That means without virtualization. And we are coming very close, like 1%, 9%, 4% kind of things. So we hope that with this kind of schemes, as soon as we make the release, if you have a virtualized environment, you should be able to use our library. And then really try to take advantage of the virtualization in the HPC domain. Okay, so that is the kind of goal. Now, some of you might be seeing, this is a new funding which has happened from the US National Science Foundation called Chameleon Cloud. This is a joint grant between Ohio State as well as TAC, Northwestern, Argonne. So this test bed will be actually deployed in the US for computation, for CS researchers, computer science researchers, to carry out research on cloud computing. These are not for end application. Okay, this is not like the exceed program. But and this is where we are trying to deploy our package. So you will see as the machines are coming up in the next few months, you will have actually MFH2 running on this platform. So please take a look at this side. So with this, let me wind up here. So as I indicated, we have been working in this field for the last 20 to 25 years. So we are continuously aiming for the exascale and trying to take a look at all these things, the memory scalability, GPUs, we are looking forward to CUDA 7 as well as this night landing, more on the collective offload framework, the RFA support, MPI tools interface, and all these things. So the goal is that if we take a look at the future, we'll see exascale systems will be constrained by power, memory per core, data movement, cost, and faults. So the programming models and the runtimes need to continuously evolve and to achieve all these things, scalability, performance, resiliency, energy awareness, programmability, and productivity. We highlighted some of the issues here, but you need continuous innovation on all these fronts. So with this, I'll try to wind up. Tomorrow, there is another session where I'll go into much more details of the Hadoop, Spark, Memcached. In fact, there is a lot of exciting work taking place there. I'll try to share some very latest numbers. We made a release yesterday night. If some of you have not taken a look at it, in-memory support for HDFS kind of thing. So very good numbers we see there. I'll try to share some of those things tomorrow. More interestingly, there is a new workshop coming out at the ISC. Myself and some of my colleagues are organizing the workshop on communication architectures at extreme scale. This is a new workshop, and if you're interested in contributing these papers, take a look at this site. It was just got accepted yesterday. The committee informed us. So we'll be soon putting a CFP and all. So please take a look at that. So these are our standard sponsors. But more importantly, these are all my heroes. What I'm presenting here is like a work of last 20 years, been done by a lot of students, staff. I just come and to this beautiful city of Lugano and give a talk, but they do all the hard work. So I want to publicly acknowledge all of them. So with this, let me stop here. If there are any quick questions, I'll be happy to take. I know we are hitting into the coffee break.